Before we start, can we recite Surah Al-Fatiha and Surah Al-Ikhlas? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, maliki yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Sirat al-lazina an'amta alayhim, ghayril maghdubi alayhim, waladdallin. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul huwallahu ahad. Allahu as-samad. لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا احد. اعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا ان هدانا الله. الصلاه والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا ابو القاسم مصطفى محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين. قال الله تعالى في الكتاب الكريم إنك لعلى خلق عظيم. صدق الله العلي العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. السلام عليكم my dear brothers and sisters. We are short in numbers today as was expected. But it's the quality not the quantity, not the quantity that counts inshallah ta'ala. So we'll continue with our talk on akhlaq with a new dimension today. And today is the last of our gatherings. May Allah accept whatever we have tried to imbibe in these nights.
Yeah.
And inshallah, in your life also a little bit of value might have been added as it has been in mine. Inshallah. So 11 days ago, or 12 evenings ago, we ushered in a new year, and a new Islamic year. It was the year 1439, right? 1439 after Hijra. And we started the year with the commemoration of the sacrifices from Rasulullah's family and their companions, like we do every year. Starting the year with sadness, which is highly unique as compared to any other community of the whole world. That the group of Muslims who call themselves the follower of the Ahlul Bayt start the Islamic year or their new year with sadness and commemorations of sacrifice. It's a very somber period of the first 2 months. Now, we were discussing Makarimul Akhlaq, the noble traits of character. And as I mentioned, it's very difficult to delve deep into these things, although I have managed to rig up a few things, few thoughts, hopefully in your minds and hearts. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alayhi wa sallam,
introduced Islam to his people, and especially when he was in Medina, people knew him, they welcomed him actually, and they were ready to learn from him, to accept the new faith. They accepted Rasulullah's family as well. Rasulullah introduced his grandsons in various ways, by carrying them on his shoulders, by talking about them in gatherings, by holding them in the laps, kissing them, by not raising his head from prostration. One of his grandsons was on his shoulder till he stepped up. People saw the importance of these grandsons, and He used words as well to convey to them that these are special children. These are the Ahlul Bayt. And even the Quran talks about the greatness of the immediate kith and kin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Rasulullah to tell the people that you do not want any rewards for what he's doing, except the love for the near and dear ones of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, what happened to the Ummah within 50 years of the passing of Rasulullah, that they could not support his younger grandson when he took a stand? Of course, they did not support his older grandson as well when he wanted to take a stand. But how come they became bloodthirsty enemies after 50 years of the Prophet's demise? That is the question. I mean, a lot of them were Muhajirun, or the people who migrated with Rasulullah from Makkah to Medina. They made huge sacrifices. They gave up their homes, and you know, Arabic people are very, very particular about their tribe, their home, their homeland. They don't give that up so easily as a lot of other communities might. And there were Ansars, the helpers, who gave everything in front of Rasulullah to help the people who had come after the migration to Medina. So, what went wrong is the question we are going to ask today. Now, as I mentioned in my one of my very first speeches in these majalis was that Islam has three aspects. One is the belief system, the aqaid, which are the roots of religion. The other is the ahkam, or the outward manifestations of the faith, like prayer, fasting, charity, going on hajj, all that, that you have to do. And the third one is are the fruits of the religion, which is the inner dimension of a religion, which is the akhlaq, or the noble traits of character. Now, the most important, of course, as you will gather, is the belief system. It's a root. The root is strong, and the root is good, then you get the good qualities, you get the correct teachings, and you build yourself from there. Once the root is good, you get a good tree, and you get good fruits. If the root is not strong, if it's diseased, then the tree is going to be hollow. And you know, a lot of Imam Hussein's enemies, not a lot, pretty much all of them, were practicing Muslims. They were doing their salat, they were doing their fasting and all that. And they were saying Allahu Akbar and La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. Those were not in question. But what I'm trying to convey is that this belief system was not solid. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't filled with the love of the Prophet's family. It wasn't filled with the love that Allah had asked the people to convey or to give to the Lord, to the Prophet's family. So it was hollow. And the tree, all these things, ahkam that they used to do, didn't bear the fruit, or the fruits were rotten. Because akhlaq, or the noble traits of character, are the fruits of the religion. And that is what was the problem there. So, you know, a lot of people who have been in the lectures in the previous nights are not here today. And it would have been useful for me to conclude with them present here, but inshallah, it'll be okay with the few of us that you made the effort to come here today. It seems like it's a very difficult job to get noble traits of character. And it is a challenging exercise, there's no question about it. But we can't just leave it because it's a challenging exercise. A lot of challenges in this world we accept. And getting noble traits of character, or taking them to a higher level, is a challenge we cannot forego, because it is not just for this world, but it's for the world afterwards as well. So, and to give you this, there's an example from a narration from Ibn Abbas, where somebody asked Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas was a very famous companion of Rasulullah and a student of Imam Ali as well, and he was a commentator of the Quran. He wrote Tafsir. And somebody asked Ibn Abbas, "What is akhlaq? What is this?" And he said a very profound statement. He said, akhlaq is walking on a narrow path, on a very narrow path, which is very sharp and thin, wearing silk clothing, and that path, along that path are thorns, and walking in such a manner that our clothes don't get torn by those thorns. This was how Ibn Abbas described what is akhlaq. The good traits of character, noble traits of character. Now, Imam Ali heard this statement of Ibn Abbas, and he called him out and said, "Don't you think people are going to get scared by this definition that you're giving?" And then Imam Ali went on to describe what noble traits of character are. He said that it is walking on that very thin, sharp path, wearing silk clothes, and then on the path, getting your clothes torn, falling on the thorns, dusting off the thorns, getting up, and then keep moving on. That is how noble traits of character are imbibed. So what I'm trying to say here is that the path might be a bit challenging, but it's not as difficult as it might seem to a lot of people. Of course, any good, important thing is going to be challenging. If you want to get a degree, you've got to work hard for it. You can't just sit down and read your book once and you'll be fine. No, it doesn't work like that. But put in the hours, go to classes, do your assignments, and then get a degree. Any class that you are in, any grade that you are in school, from one grade to the other, it becomes more and more challenging. You have got to work harder because you're learning more and more, and you're developing more and more. So, akhlaq is not hard if you make an intention and keep working on it, slowly by slowly. We will never be perfect, but we can always aim and try for perfection. No, we are not sinless. Allah hasn't made us sinless, but we can avoid sins to a large degree, especially when we have loving family members around. You know, somebody said, this was Hassan al-Basri. He said that it must be so difficult to enter into paradise. And Imam Sajjad alayhi salam countered him by saying, how difficult it must be to enter hellfire when we have a Lord as merciful as ours. So, it is all about gaining Allah's mercy by showing our true intentions and working towards it. Allah is not looking at a perfect result. Allah is looking at our sincere efforts and our intention to go towards perfection. And that's what Allah is looking for. And everybody has a personal journey, like I mentioned before in my previous talks as well in the majalis, that we have our own journeys, and akhlaq is about the inner dimensions. It's not going to be something that you're doing for somebody else. It's always going to be something that we do for ourselves and our nearness to Allah. We do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it shines through to other people as well. It becomes very clear to people when people are good. And it's also very clear to people when people are bad. Now, we do not get into Jannah by our own efforts. If we do a lot of salat and saum and a lot of good things that we are supposed to do in religion, and we say, okay, we've done it, Jannah, no problem. That's where the downfall begins. Because Jannah is only through the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know, we have heard stories and we've heard narrations. A lot of people have been on the wrong for many years, and then they have changed and made sincere repentance and have changed towards the path of Allah, and Allah has forgiven them. Allah is just as well. We will be accountable for what we did in the past at some point or the other, and we will have to pay for that. But Jannah is for everybody. Allah didn't create hell for everybody. Hell is for the worst of the people. The worst, you know, who don't even repent. I mean, my teacher, when I was in class, used to say that Allah forgives small sins without even repentance, sometimes. And He forgives even the gunah kabira if we repent. So, don't feel disheartened when we make mistakes. And if you analyze ourselves and think that, oh, we are too far away from real goodness, don't. The idea is to be encouraged to work towards our merciful Lord, because He's merciful. If it wasn't for the mercy, a lot of things that we have today wouldn't be coming to us, because we don't deserve anything. Who said we deserve anything? Just because we were born in a certain family, we didn't deserve certain things? It doesn't work like that. When we assume that we deserve it, because we see our parents are doing okay, and I've been brought up in this family, and my uncles are like this, and my aunties are like that, and my grandparents are like this, so I'm also going to be like that. No. The mercy can be taken away, and it will be finished. We won't even know what happened. I've known a few stories like that, you know, where people have been suddenly starting to struggle. And some people have suddenly changed from their struggle to bounties falling in their lap. Allah knows why He does it, but it is the grace of Allah that we are here in this world with the mercy, and how we are surviving in comfort and ease. So we must make use of it. That's what we are here to do in this world. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. I want to share some contemporary issues regarding akhlaq. And we started late, so we're short of time today. So there are a lot of issues that come with the passage of time, the development of society. And Rasulullah's time, when He gave us instructions, a lot of time has passed by. Now we have challenges of the 21st century, not even 20th century. We are born in the 20th century, and when we compare those times to times now, we think those times are much better. When I was in my teenage years, I was thinking, oh my God, so challenging.